which I can't tell because the thing in back isn't lit up. So if someone do that, I have to turn around. So we have a special event later today. Right after worship will be a fellowship meal. So that's not quite the same as birthday cake, but I bet that there's going to be some desserts over there as well. So that will be after our worship service. And we have some other things to celebrate today as well, which are a birthday. Rich is not here. Rich is here. Rich is here. So Rich is here. We're going to sing happy birthday to Rich.
And also to Jean the day before.
Oh, to Jean. Oh,
wow.
All right. There'll be a new series starting next week. And is that it for announcements? Okay, all right. So I guess that's it for announcements. I wanted to mention, we don't have a slide for it, not this Wednesday, but the following Wednesday, we will be starting a new book study of the Screwtape Letters that will be taking place at Trinity Presbyterian Church, our yoke partner across town. If some of you might have been part of the Confessions class we did last summer, it'll be kind of the same idea there, but with a different book. So we'll be starting that in a week and a bit. If you'd like to be part of that and you don't have a copy of the Screwtape Letters, let me know and I'll make sure you can get one. All right, I think that's it. There we go. All right, our call to worship today comes to us from Paul's letter to the Romans, and he reminds us that by God's Holy Spirit, not just people, but all of creation is being renewed. Here is what he says. We know that the whole creation is groaning together and suffering labor pains up until now. And it's not only the creation. We ourselves, who have the Spirit as the first crop of the harvest, also groan inside as we wait to be adopted and for our bodies to be set free. Let us pray. Almighty God, at the Feast of Pentecost, you sent your Holy Spirit to your disciples, filling them with joy and boldness to preach the gospel. Empower us today with that same Spirit to witness to your redeeming love for all people to use. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is alive and rules all things with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and always. Amen. Please stand as you're able and turn to sing our opening songs.
may choose to be holy, but we don't always succeed. But the Apostle Paul assures us that God helps us with our prayers. He says the Spirit comes to help our weakness. We don't know what we should pray, but the Spirit himself pleads our case with unexpressed groans. Confident of God's love and mercy, let us confess the wrong we have done first in silence. Please pray with me. Almighty God, at Pentecost, you poured your Spirit upon your gathered disciples, creating bold tongues, open ears, and a new community of faith. We confess we hold back the force of your Spirit among us. We do not listen for your word of grace or speak the good news of your love or live as a people made one in Christ. Have mercy on us, O God. Transform our timid lives by the power of your Spirit and fill us with a burning desire to be your faithful people, doing your will for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news proclaimed by the Apostle Peter on that first Pentecost day. He cites the prophet Joel. The sun will be changed into darkness and the moon will be changed into blood before the great and spectacular day of the Lord comes. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. People of God, look to the cross and believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Since we have peace with God, let us be people of peace in the world. May the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Take a moment and show your neighbor a sign of God's peace.
Thank you.
younger people up here. We got seats for a couple more. And
there's always SRO, or you can be standing. All right. All right. Okay. It's a good problem to have, right? So, all right. All right. So, I want to ask you, do you know what these are? What are these things?
Fossils?
They might be fossils in a couple of zillion years, but no, these aren't fossils yet. These are just plain old bones. These are bones. So we talk a lot about bones. What do bones symbolize? So, like, if there's a skull up above them like this, what's a symbol of? Do you know what cross bones mean? Okay, it does mean dead. It's a symbol of piracy. So I'm not a very good skull. Way too much flesh on this skull. So, but these are little tiny bones, and in a pirate flag, they'd be great big, you know, leg bones or something. So, bones have symbols, and the reason bones make a good symbol, and the reason is because everybody recognizes a bone means something died. In this case, a chicken died. So, so these are chicken bones, and they were the ones that I had. I don't have any bodies in my house that I could get human bones out of. So, all right, so. So these are bones, and in our lesson today, we read about God gives this symbol of a valley filled with bones, and the idea is that God brings those bones back to life. And the reason for that is because there's if you wanted a symbol of what is dead as dead can be, it's a bone, right? I mean, this chicken is never going to squawk again, right? We're pretty sure about that. But God says, even dead things I can bring back to life. And one of the things that one of the ways God does that is through his word. So in the Bible, God says that his word is life. And so one of the things we've got today for younger people who are graduating is we've got God's word in the form of the Bible. So the Bible is God's word written down. Jesus is ultimately God's word. But the Bible is a means that God uses to bring people to life, that the Bible actually brings people to life. So we have Bibles for our young people who are graduating. So let me get this collection of Bibles here. All right, so we have somebody who's graduating from 7th to 8th grade, Sophia. It is a pleasure, yes. And let's see, here's Madeline.
Thank you.
And that's for you. And you're graduating for 3rd grade. Yeah. And then Victoria, this is for you as well. So that's good. So our hope as a church is that you find the life that God wants you to have as you read his word. So that is our gift to you, and we pray that you will actually use it and find life. Let's pray. God, your word assures us that you bring life to what is impossibly dead. And so, Lord, help us to have faith that the people that we know and care about who have died, and the other things that die, the things, our hopes and our dreams, all the things, Lord, that die in us, that they can live again because of Christ. Help us to be reminded of this, and help us to see it as we read your word. Through Christ our Lord, amen. All right, thanks for coming up, and thanks for coming to get your Bibles. Oh, she's lost all of her energy. All right, off you go, off you go. Bye-bye. All right. All right. So. Where are we? So. The psalmist reminds us that everything we have is a gift that God has given us. And so we return to God a portion of what God's given us as a sign of our confidence. God will continue to give us everything we need, and also as an expression of our gratitude. Here's what the psalmist writes. All your creations wait for you to give them their food on time. When you give it to them, they gather it up. When you open your hand, they are filled completely full. But when you hide your face, they're terrified. When you take away their breath, they die and return to dust. When you let loose your breath, they are created, and you make the surface of the ground brand new again. If you would like to give to God through this church to support the work that God is doing in and beyond this church, I invite you to do so. We have lots of different ways. There's a giving box in back, there's the mail, there's electronic giving. But whether you choose to return something to God through this church or through some other agency or cause that you believe is close to God's heart, I invite you to do so as an act of thanksgiving and faith. Let us pray. God of wind and word and fire, we bless your name this day for sending the light and strength of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for all of the gifts, great and small, that have been poured out upon your children. Accept us and our gifts to be living praise and witness to your love through all the earth. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. As we continue in our time of prayer, I'd like to invite those of you who are worshiping with us online, please do use the chat just so other people know that they're not alone, that other people are worshiping today online as well. There's usually 4 to 6 of you, and so please do let them know that you're there, and if there are particular ways that they can be in prayer for you or just to share the joy that you have, please do use that as well. Let us pray. O God, you sent the Holy Spirit to ignite a burning energy in Christ's followers as they waited in Jerusalem for the gift that he had promised. Pour the same inspiration on your people who have assembled here today and on the Church of Christ throughout the world. We pray, O God, for the unity of the church, knowing that we are divided in so many different sects and denominations. We pray for her mission, that we would be effective in reaching the people who do not know your love in Christ. We pray for her ministers, for her disciples, and for her members. But we pray especially for those whom you call to faith through your church. Give urgency to all who have experienced your love. Revive the power of the gospel in our hearts, so it may be for us a sacred mission to be about the work of blessing your creation. Lord, we pray for the world in which your church ministers, for its leaders and its institutions, for those who are affected by economic turmoil and other types of turmoil, including violence in other places in Northern Africa, in the Gaza Strip, in Ukraine, and so many other places in this sad and sorry world. Lord, we ask that you would enable your church to spread the good news of your salvation so people of every tribe and tongue may hear it in their own language and welcome it into their lives. We ask you to equip and encourage all the members of the body of Christ to use their gifts in your service. Today, O God, we pray for a large church in our nation, Gateway Church of Southlace, Texas, and its pastor, Robert Morris. We pray as well for a church that is related to us through our denomination, the United Methodist Church of Chugiak and their pastor, Jim Depkin, and New Hope Presbyterian Church in North Pole, Alaska. We pray as well, O God, for a church that shares this mission field with us here in the Sand Lake area, First Methodist Baptist Church and their pastor, Leonard Ford. We pray as well, Lord, for our own fellowship and for the concerns that we lift up to you now in the silent intentions of our hearts. With these concerns, O God, we pray as well for our church, so that as Jesus is lifted up, he may draw all people to him, and the kingdoms of the world may become the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is in his name we lift this prayer. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray together as our Savior taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Please pray with me. O God, who frees us from the darkness, we pray that you will send your Holy Spirit to move us to understanding, to help us to believe the gospel, and to give us strength and wisdom to live by. Amen. This morning's reading is from Ezekiel chapter 37, verses 1 through 14. Listen for God's word to you. The Lord's power overcame me. And while I was in the Lord's Spirit, he led me out and set me down in the middle of a certain valley. It was full of bones. He led me through them all around, and I saw that there were great many of them on the valley floor, and they were very dry. He asked me, "Human one, can these bones live again?" I said, "Lord God, only you know." He said to me, "Prophesy over these bones and say to them, 'Dry bones, hear the Lord's word. The Lord God proclaims to these bones, I am about to put breath in you, and you will live again. I will put sinews on you, place flesh on you, and cover you with skin. When I put breath in you and you come to life, you will know that I am the Lord.' I prophesied just as I was commanded. There was a great noise as I was prophesying, then a great quaking, and the bones came together, bone by bone. When I looked, suddenly there were sinews on them, the flesh appeared, and then they were covered over with skin. But there was still no breath in them. He said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, human one. Say to the breath, the Lord God proclaims, come from the four winds, breath. Breathe into these dead bodies and let them live.' I prophesied just as he commanded me. When the breath entered them, they came to life and stood on their feet, an extraordinarily large company. He said to me, 'Human one, these bones are the entire house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up and our hope has perished. We are completely finished. So now prophesy and say to them, the Lord God proclaims, I'm opening your graves. I will raise you up from your graves, my people, and I will bring you to Israel's fertile land. You will know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and raise you up from your graves, my people. I will put my breath in you, and you will live. I will plant you on your fertile land, and you will know that I am the Lord. I've spoken, and I will do it. This is what the Lord says." Thanks be to God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Have you ever faced doom? When I was in college, I faced doom. Myself and two friends of mine were sitting in the back row of Computer Science 342, and Dr. Tagva wrote the grades of the last test up on the board. And he drew lines under them, and he said to the people under the last group of grades, he said, "I brought drop cards for you." And then he looked right up at me and my two friends, and we were in the next group up, and he said, "And I will flunk you too if you don't get better grades." I don't remember the words. I remember "flunk you." And, you know, I blocked out the rest. Have you ever faced that moment of clarity when you realized that hope was lost? As it turns out, he was warning us because hope was not lost. But I felt doom. Have you ever felt that sinking feeling, it's like, oh my goodness, This is really it. There is no hope. I had a doctor once interrupt our visit, and he said, "Can I pray for you?" And that's great, but it's not. But it's not. It's terrifying, right? When the doctor says, "Let me pray for you," you know, it's like if I said, "Let me operate on you," right? So it is that moment when you hear the bad news. Somebody calls you and says there's been an accident, or maybe it's in the doctor's office. Maybe it's the technician. And, you know, technician's not a doctor. They don't get to tell you what the test means, but you can see in their face that it's bad. Have you felt that, the sense of doom? Maybe it was what led to your divorce, that conversation, that argument. Maybe it was in a lawyer's office, that sense of doom, where you just realized that there was no other alternative but bankruptcy. If you have felt that, well actually, if you have not felt that, if you have never felt that sense of doom, just wait, because the world is a hard place. The world is a very hard place, and there's a lot of ways that it eventually makes our lives hard. If it hasn't bothered you, trust me, you will hear about it. So whether it's, you know, just last week we had the solar flares, and they tell us that if the sun had been aimed just slightly different, it could have ended civilization. And the sun is not done with solar flares yet, so sleep peacefully tonight. But you know, whether it's that or it's climate change, whether it's racism, whether it's demographic collapse, whether it is a big problem that hasn't affected you personally, but you just can't imagine how people can ever fix it, or whether it's something that's as personal as a punch in the face. If you've ever faced that moment of okay, this is it, there's no hope left, then the good news is you're not the only person who's ever felt that. That our reading today is addressed specifically to a group of people who maybe were feeling that right then. They certainly had faced that feeling. So our reading today is from the book of the prophet Ezekiel, and it's called The Vision of the Valley of Dry Bones, if you've got headings or something like that in your Bible. And it's addressed to, as I said, people who had that moment of clarity when they realized there was nothing left that they could do, that they were ultimately doomed. And it is an example of, it's actually one of the earliest examples in the Bible of what is called apocalyptic literature. So apocalyptic literature gets its name from the apocalypse, the book of Revelation. And it is the type of literature, or I would say that's a supreme example of apocalyptic literature. But it's 22 chapters long, and it's kind of hard to get your head wrapped around it. The piece we're going to read today is actually, you could think of it as kind of the little scale on the side of the map that says how many miles are. It's a nice, digestible piece of apocalyptic literature, so you can understand what it's about. And what you'll see is it has strange symbols, just like the book of Revelation does. There's these strange things. And ultimately, its purpose is to peel back the curtain, to reveal something, to uncover something. That's what the word apocalypse actually means, to uncover a hidden reality. Now you can see what's really going on. You can get a look behind the scenes, you know, pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. That's the idea, is I'm going to give you a peek so you can see what's really going on. And so the prophet Ezekiel gets that peek that he can then share with the people that he's writing to. So, who is Ezekiel, and who is that group of people he's writing to? Well, Ezekiel was a person living in Jerusalem in the 6th century, the end of the 7th century, and the beginning of the 6th century BC, which is not a good time to live in Jerusalem. So that would have been a great time to live on a field, you know, in a farm 200 miles away, because right then Babylon was in the process of conquering the Holy Land. So the area around Jerusalem was called Judah, and it had a king, and the king was paying tribute, regular tribute, to the Babylonian Empire, and he got the idea that it would be good if he could just skip paying the tribute. And the empire, the Babylonian Empire, said that's not a good idea, and so they defeated Judah in battle, and they deported a bunch of people from Babylon. They said, we're going to round up the troublemakers and we're going to send you all to Babylon. So they did that. And one of the people, we don't know how much of a troublemaker he is, but one of the people that they rounded up and marched off to Babylon was the prophet Ezekiel. So that happened in 597 BC. And you can imagine that was not pleasant. It's 900-mile walk. So imagine somebody's marching you up to dead horse. Okay, not a pleasant walk, and who knows what's going to happen when you get there, right? You're going to be, you know, essentially a slave in this land where you don't even speak the language. That's the situation. So they may have felt doom already, but if they didn't already feel doom, then they certainly did 11 years later when news came to them that the king who was running Judah at that time decided to do the exact same thing again, and this time Babylon said, all right, that's it. And they destroyed Jerusalem. They destroyed the palace. They destroyed the temple. They pretty much carried away anybody who could read or write, anybody who had any money. They left only the most basic type of menial workers left in what was left of Jerusalem. They knocked down the walls. They destroyed Jerusalem as much as they could. And when the word came to the exiles living in Babylon, you know, I could keep hope alive. I can go back to Jerusalem, but now you're telling me there's no Jerusalem. Jerusalem's been destroyed. How can I possibly have any hope? So it is at that moment that Ezekiel is writing. He's writing to the people whose hope has been utterly crushed. If it wasn't already when they were first marched off to Babylon, it is now. So that's the situation when he has this vision. So he says, we're reading in chapters 37, and he says, the Lord's power overcame me, and while I was in the Lord's spirit, he led me out and set me down in the middle of a certain valley. So this is a vision, a fantastic vision he's about to have, and it was filled with bones. Now, there was no valley that was filled with bones. This is symbolic, and we're going to get an interpretation in a minute. But he says, he led me through them all around, and I saw that there were a great many of them in the valley floor, and they were very dry. This is not a bunch of bodies. It's not like after a battle where there's a bunch of bodies lying on the ground. This is a long time afterwards, and the elements and the predators and scavengers have had their way. There's nothing left but bones, and the bones are dry. So these things are as dead gets. And God asks him, human one, can these bones live again? And Ezekiel hedges. I mean, he knows, no, not a chance. No way, these bones are dead. There's no way they can live again. Definitely not. But he hedges. He's a prophet. You know, he works for God. He says, on the other hand, that's just my opinion. You know. He says, Lord God, you know. I have an opinion, but you know. And God says to him, prophesy over these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the Lord's word. The Lord God proclaims to these bones, I'm about to put breath in you and you will live again. I will put sinews on you, place flesh on you, and cover you with skin. When I put breath in you and you come to life, you will know that I am the Lord. So God says, you're going to be instrumental in making that happen. And so he does. I prophesied just as I was commanded, and there was a great noise as I was prophesying and a great quaking, and the bones came together bone by bone. And when I looked, suddenly there appeared. So the skeletons reassemble, and suddenly there was sinews on them, flesh appeared, and they were covered over with skin. So now they are dead bodies. He says that they are corpses, they're cadavers, but there's still no breath in them. And so God says to him, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, human one. Say to the breath, the Lord God proclaims, come from the four winds, breath, breathe into these dead bodies and let them live. So there's a play on words here. In all the biblical languages, in Hebrew, in Greek, in Latin, the word for breath is also the word for spirit. We get that a little bit of that when we talk about respiration. You can hear the word spirit in there. So the idea is that the spirit is the difference. You know, 6 centuries before Christ, they didn't know a lot about medicine, but they knew that if the body wasn't breathing, it's a body, and if it is breathing, it's not dead yet. So that's where they got that concept. That's where they linked the two. And so There's no breath in them. They are still dead bodies. And God says to him, he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, human one. Say to the breath, the Lord God proclaims, come from the four winds. So the breath is called forth from all the corners of the world. And he does. And when the breath entered them, they came to life and stood on their feet, an extraordinarily large company. So that's the vision. He sees these bones reassembled into skeletons, and the skeletons become corpses, and then the corpses are brought to life. So that's his vision. But we don't know yet what it means. So he hears God explain the vision. So this is the apocalyptic part where it's uncovered. God says to him, human one, these bones are the entire house of Israel. So these are not just the region around Jerusalem, not just Judah, but the country to the north, Israel. So that had been conquered by a different empire like 150 years earlier. And God is saying, no, all of you, the entire house of Israel, they are these bones, and I will bring them back to life. God says, they're saying our bones are dried up. They're having that moment of it's hopeless. You know, there's just nothing for it. There's nothing I can do. I can't see my way out of this situation. That's what they're saying. Our bones are dried up. Our hope has perished. We're completely finished. And so you, Ezekiel, you prophesy to them and say, the Lord God proclaims, I'm opening your graves. You say, we're dead. I'm opening your graves. I will raise you up from your graves, my people, and I will bring you back to Israel's fertile land. I'm going to restore things to the way they were before. I'm going to bring you back to your country. You're not going to be stuck here in Babylon. And this is essentially the same thing that Ezekiel said in chapter 36. But in chapter 36, he just says it. It's pretty dry. God says, I'm going to do this, 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 and this. So God gives him a set of promises, but it's not memorable. You know, if you think, why did Jesus tell stories? Because stories are memorable. Visions are memorable. So God says to him, I'll gather you from all the countries. I'll bring you to your own fertile land. I'll bring you to your own fertile land, and I will make abundant the orchards and fruits and fields produce. So he makes this promise that everything will be restored to the way it was. So God makes this promise, but here he makes this vivid image. And it's as if God is saying, I want you to remember this. Don't forget what I've promised, because I want you to hold me to this. Don't let it slip out of your mind. So God gives this fantastic vision of skeletons rising up from the dead. So as I was looking at this, I was thinking, it's some of this is lost on some of it is definitely lost on us, and the rest might be lost on us because we're 2,000 years this side of Easter, and the idea of things coming up out of their graves is a conventional idea. Christians are familiar with the idea of resurrection, so it's not as challenging to us as it would have been to Ezekiel's audience. They would have been unfamiliar. I mean, there are hints throughout the scriptures, but it wasn't ever as blatant as this. The idea of I will bring you up out of your grave and put my breath in you. That this is one of the places where God is saying, I want you to realize that death is not the end. I'm working on something. I'm fixing what's broken in the world. And so that would have been challenging to them. But almost as challenging, and again, this is something that's lost on us, almost as challenging to them is the idea that the God 900 miles away has power here. That our God, the God of the that we encountered in the Holy Land, actually has authority and power here in Babylon. You know, Babylon's got its own gods, but you're telling me that our God, the God of Israel, actually has authority here? That would have been startling to them just as well. So God is making these promises, and he's saying, this is going to be challenging for you. And so I want you to have a vivid picture of what it is that I'm promising. So what is it that God is saying? Well, the first thing God is saying is that when I'm involved, despair is never warranted. So with God, despair is unwarranted, that there's no justification to be in despair when God is involved. Some of you may be familiar with, maybe you've had to become familiar with the five stages of grieving. And you, if you do, you know that the fifth stage is acceptance. And what God is saying here is, yes, you have to come to grips with it, but you should always keep an asterisk there. Because with God, despair is never warranted, and hope is always warranted. If not for this life, then in the life to come. So that is the first promise that God makes. God says, I will restore things the way they were. And that's the first part of the vision. God says, prophesy over these bones, and they become dead creatures again. But then God says, prophesy to the breath, and the breath will go into them. So it does. And this is also part of the list of things that is said in verse 36. God says, I'm not just going to restore things the way that they were. In chapter 36, he spells it out. He says, I will give you a new heart. I will sprinkle clean water on you. Will be cleansed of all your pollution. I will cleanse you of all your idols. I'll give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I'll remove your stony heart and replace it with a living one. So God says, it's not going to be like it was before. See, I'm not just going to change your circumstances. I'm not just going to move you from Babylon to back to the Holy Land. I'm not just going to fix things back the way they were. I'm going to change you. I'm going to change you on the inside. So God says, I will breathe life into you, and then you will truly live. You will live in a way that you couldn't before. So the second point in the outline, if you're following, is that God is not promising merely restoration, but renewal. God is going to make things new again. And renewal is inspired. Renewal has to be inspired, that God has to breathe his breath into us to inspire us. So what do we do with this? Well, the first thing is we do hang on to hope, that we don't accept that moment of doom. We say, well, yeah, that's true. I don't have any more ideas. I'm like Ezekiel saying, Lord, you know, right? I look at a valley full of dry bones and I say, that's it. They're done. There's nothing for it. But the Lord knows, and I only think. So hold on to that. When I go to the hospital, I pray for healing. You know, it's my prayer that the person who's in that bed right now looking pretty bad will jump up and do cartwheels down the hall, and the doctors and nurses will all be stunned by it. That's my prayer, right? It has yet to happen, but it's my prayer because I believe that God can do that if it is God's will. But I know that God can bring us back to our loved ones in the resurrection. So one way or the other, this is a temporary thing. They'll either get better now or they'll get better eventually in the renewal of all things. So I pray for God's will to be done, but I pray for God to heal that person. And if you're thinking, if there's something that is on your mind, something that you're saying, well, yeah, but what about this situation? What about the doom I'm facing? What about my finances? What about the thing that I'm in the hospital for, the person I care about's in the hospital for? Pray. God, you have made promises. You have committed yourself to being a God of resurrection. So I pray for restoration. But the other thing we can do is we can experience God's Spirit in us to change not just our circumstances, but to change us from the inside out, as different as a corpse and a living body. We can ask for God to change us from the inside out. So, what does that look like? Well, I don't know. I mean, if you think about the things that we want, the circumstances, maybe what it looks like is not getting into that problem again, that it's not just going to be lather, rinse, repeat. It's going to be my circumstances change, but also I've changed. And now I've learned something, I've grown, I've become a different person. And that doesn't, that's not a path that I will follow in the future. So we can pray both for the restoration, but also the renewal. So let me ask you, what would it be like if you were actually changed on the inside? If you were to experience the kind of new life that is seen in this image, what would that look like in your life? How would it change your circumstances? How would it work in you and out of you to actually change your circumstances? Today is Pentecost. It is the day we remember that Jesus fulfilled his promise to send the Spirit to breathe life into his body, which is the church. It's why we remember Pentecost as the birthday of the church, because it is the day that the church, the body of Christ, received God's Spirit. And if you think over the last 2,000 years, what God has done with miserable, sorry people like me and like you, what God has been able to do through the church, imagine that same power working in you individually in your life. And then, if you can imagine that, imagine what the church can still do in the future. I think for those of us in mainline churches, it's easy to be doomers, to be thinking, well, you know, that's it, we're doomed. Our life, our life has gone out of us. Our bones are dried up. But you know, with God, anything can happen. And so on this Pentecost, one of the things we can do is we can pray for the renewal of the church as well. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for giving us a fresh vision of what your promises entail, that the Easter stories are so familiar to us that we forget just how strange and important your promises are. So Lord, help us to truly believe that your promises are not only to restore us to our situations, but to actually renew us from the inside out. Help us to be renewed people. Help us to be your church, like Ezekiel, proclaiming hope to a world that is filled with so much despair and doom. We ask this in Christ's name and for his sake. Amen. Please stand as you're able and join in singing our response to this word. God, amazing. grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and forevermore. Amen. Amen.
Sidewalk chalking and shit like that. It's going to take a little while for us to get murdered.
Yeah.